Thanks very much, Irene. Can everyone hear me? And online, everyone can hear me? Great. So this is a project that's joint with Natalie Cox at Princeton and Ricardo Fonseca, who's a grad student at Brown. And at a very high level, this paper is about this, I think, famous, often bastardized quote by George Box: all models are wrong, but some are useful. I like the pose. So this paper, again, very generally, is about how effective school choice assignment mechanisms are when they're constructed based on incorrect models. Okay, and what do I mean by incorrect model? Why is that interesting? Well, in school choice, often stability is the number one desirable property. And the mechanisms that we use to solicit student preferences ask for preferences over school programs, right? Just over school programs. But peers matter. I'll show you on the next slide a little bit what I mean about that. But students aren't able to separately tell us their preferences about peers and about the programs they want to attend. Okay. And so today I want to talk a little bit about peer preferences just to start us off. I'm not going to be talking about couples, because of course there's a famous matching literature about that. Instead, I'm going to talk about more anonymous preferences. So students might care about the overall student body, or the distribution of types as to where they go. There's been a fair bit of research recently about different types of functional forms of preferences people might have. So there are a number of papers that look at big pond preferences, what I've called, and that's something like, well, I want my child, or the student themselves wants to go to a place where the students are just better, right? Higher in ability, whatever ability or quality means. Another strand of the literature looks at kind of this big fish effect where, you know, maybe I'm okay with peers being better, but I don't want them to overmatch me, right? And so there's somehow some situation where I don't want to go to a place where students are too much better than I am. And you can, of course, imagine any number of other kind of functional forms, and we want a setting that's kind of general enough for all of these. And so we're going to study peer preferences of this type, which is I care about the distribution of peers somehow, but without putting too many restrictions on it. But dealing with peers really isn't an easy problem, right? So you don't know who your peers are going to be in kind of our classic school choice setup because, well, the matching isn't created yet, right? Everything's done all at once. And because the preferences are over, you know, the entire student body, it's not like a couple where, you know, I'm not able to just coordinate with my wife, because in this case, my wife is everyone, right? So coordination of that type is very difficult. And the last thing is, of course, you could imagine a situation where we just ask people their preferences as functions, right? Or, you know, this infinitely long menu, how much do you like Harvard if the students look like this versus Stanford if the students look like this, and do all these possible combinations. And that seems like a pretty complex thing. There's some work by Budish and Kessler saying, you know, this type of thing is probably a little bit too complex for people to actually look at. And so really what I want to talk about today is what I think of as the status quo that's done in a number of school choice markets. This is both in centralized school choice markets. I'll talk a little bit about the school choice market in New South Wales, Australia. China's school choice market for university admissions also the same way. Even decentralized markets like the US are this way, where prior to submitting their preferences or prior to applying, students are told information about the student body in the previous year. Okay, so there's this kind of learning from the past notion, right? So in the US, there's this US News and World Report that publishes the SAT score and the GPA of the entering cohort each year. Okay, and so to give you an example of this from our empirical setting, New South Wales, Australia, they say the current year peer information, this was in 2016, for the 2015-16 admissions won't be known until the selection's actually made. So use the previous year's information as a guide when deciding how to submit your preferences. Okay, so there's this notion of learning from the past. And so, you know, there are kind of two different avenues that we take in this paper. One is an empirical one, which I'm not going to talk about just for time reasons. But we can use information shocks to students' beliefs about their relative ability compared to their peers at each program to understand their preferences over peers. We can use this to measure things like misallocation, lack of stability, and we can see how, you know, these things correlate with attrition. And there's this theory component, which I'll spend most of the time talking about, which is we take this status quo process where people learn from the past, and we show that this induces a sort of tâtonnement process, okay? And this tâtonnement process is gonna give us a pretty simple test that we can take to the data and use this to see, hey, are we getting close to stability or not? Okay. So let me jump into the model. So it's going to be a continuum model. So this type space is going to be this big theta, right? So this is of course something done for convenience, and the results will apply to large finite markets. But you may have seen these continuum models before. In particular, Eduardo Azevedo and Jacob Leshnow have some work on this. So if you've seen any of these papers by these authors, those are probably in the right way to get your intuition going. So this type space theta, this big theta, we're going to have this measure eta over this type space. And we're going to have a n plus 1 programs, right, where programs 1 through n are real programs, and they're each are going to have some capacity that's positive. And then there's this outside option, q0, which can take all the students. Okay. And a matching is going to be standard in this context. So a matching is a measurable function. It matches students to schools. It matches schools, and sorry, I'm mixing schools and programs. I mean the same thing. Students are assigned to one program. Programs are assigned to some measurable subset of students that doesn't violate its capacity, and the assignments are two-way. So if I'm assigned to CU, then if you look at CU's matching, you should find my name there as well. Okay. And I haven't told you what the student types are, so from this set big theta, but each student is going to have two components to their type, and those are going to be, first, a score. So that's this r theta c. So this is an n plus 1 dimensional vector. So how much does each program like me? Okay, that's my ranking. And this u theta is going to represent my utility, if I'm student theta, from attending program c given matching mu, right? So given the distribution of students that's defined by this matching, how much do I like to go to a particular school? And of course, because we're caring about peer preferences, my utility may depend on who the peers are. And this squiggly theta given mu is just going to represent the ordinal rankings. Okay. So let me say a couple things. So I've only talked about kind of ability in this kind of like abstract notion. This is how much do the schools like me. And this is an n plus 1 dimensional vector. You could, of course, add in any number of things like group identity, gender, left-handedness, anything like that. Nothing would really change, but I'll stick with this. And so the additional assumption I'm going to make is that students really only care about ability here. Okay? And what do I mean about ability? This kind of captures the anonymous notion, which is think of this function lambda as telling us the entire distribution of abilities of the students. And so what do I mean by that? I mean, it's basically a CDF. So it says, look, you tell me who the students, you tell me an n plus 1 dimensional vector, how many students have are at that school who have scores less than this component-wise, okay? So we can think of this as mapping out how many students roughly of each ability type are there, okay? And our notion of stability is largely unchanged, with the distinction that we're going to have this theta given mu here. Okay, so a student and program pair are going to block a matching if the student, given the matching that's actually constructed, prefers to go to another program, and that program is willing to take them. What do I mean by that? I mean either the program has excess seats, or doesn't have excess seats, but it's admitted a student who has a lower score. So I call up CU. I say, hey, I'd rather come to you given your student body than wherever I am. And they say, yes, we either have an extra seat or we can kick someone out and take you. Okay. And so a matching is going to satisfy this notion of pairwise stability if there are none of these blocking pairs. Okay. And as an aside in the paper, we give some axiomatic basis for why we think this is the right notion of stability. Okay. So let me get into the results. So the first result is really just an existence result, which is good if you actually want to construct a stable matching. If peer preferences are something like, we call this aggregate unresponsive, and I'll say what that means in a second, then there's going to exist a stable matching, but not necessarily just one. And so aggregate unresponsive, I mean, if we change the peers a little bit, right, so we take the overall composition of peers at all the schools, we change this a little bit, not that many people are going to change their ordinal rankings, right? So it might be that my preferences are discontinuous, but it's not that all of our preferences are discontinuous right at the same point. Okay, so small changes in peers lead to small changes in ordinal rankings. Okay. So I want to get back to this notion of learning from the past, right? So we have this issue. We don't know how to find a stable matching because we'd have to, if we wanted to, solicit these preferences as functions of the peers, and that seems a little bit complicated. But there's at least one case in which just using a vanilla deferred acceptance algorithm is going to go well, and that's if students have pretty good beliefs about who the students are going to be, right? So if I know who's going to be at CU Boulder, I can just roll that into my preferences. I say, look, I have some preference for CU Boulder. I have some preference for the students who I expect to be there. I combine these, and then I rank the schools in this ordinal way, and then I submit this to the market maker. Okay, so that's one way we would think of this. And so the question really becomes, okay, if the beliefs matter, where do the beliefs come from? And this is where the learning from the past comes from. Students learn the ability distribution of students in the previous period, and here's an example in this New South Wales market. It's by law they have to show some summary statistics since 2017. They actually have to show more. So this is a very salient piece of information. But we can see the students learn from this. And from a modeling perspective, this leads to this discrete time process, right? So let's just for now think of, you know, every year the market's exactly the same in terms of the programs that are offered and the distribution of student types. And each student's just gonna observe the matching in the previous period, or really all we need is they just need to observe the distribution of types of students in the previous period, okay? And then students are gonna observe this, they're gonna submit their preferences using deferred acceptance. And if they have sufficiently strong beliefs, right, if they actually believe that the students are going to look the same this year as last year, then, you know, we should expect them to report their preferences truthfully given what they saw last year, right? So I should submit my ordinal preferences as if the students are going to look this year like they did last year. So that's an assumption we're going to make. If you don't like that assumption, I don't blame you. We do a fair bit of empirical work to show that this is true. Later, I'm not going to talk about this. We actually construct a mechanism where the incentive properties actually make it so that students should believe this. But let me just put this aside and just say, for today's talk, as an assumption, you see what happened last year, you think that's what's going to happen this year, and you best respond to that. Okay. And so notice that this induces a tâtonnement process, right? So whatever the student body looked like last year, that's going to play the role of prices, right? I'm going to best respond to that. And our intuition from grad micro, and I know this is a computer science audience partly, I don't think this notion is unfamiliar. If we see that these prices are converging, that's the same in an exchange economy, that's something like reaching equilibrium, right? And so that's exactly the result we're gonna have, okay? So what it says is, if we look at this ability distribution at all the schools, if and only if this thing converges, have we arrived at a stable matching? Okay, so this implies a test, which means you don't have to know anything about the functional form of peer preferences. All you have to do is you have to have this time series data. And what you do is you look at all the schools and say, okay, are the students kind of converging in their ability at these programs from year to year? And if yes, then you found a stable matching, and if no, then not. Okay. And so really the question becomes, does this status quo process, which we've nicknamed TIM, tâtonnement with intermediate matching, does it converge? And so let me try to end on this example here. We have one program, C, with capacity Q, and the student scores are going to be distributed uniform 0-1. There's just one school, so it's just going to be a one-dimensional object. Students are going to care about the mean of the students the mean of the scores of the students who are enrolled. Okay, so they all get zero utility for being unmatched. And then if they're matched to the school, they get a utility V theta, which is just some kind of intrinsic component. And then they have to pay some cost if they're overmatched by their peers. So if their score is less than the mean. Okay, so this is like this big fish preferences where students prefer not to be overmatched. Okay, so it's V theta minus K if you're overmatched. And we have to pick somehow to initialize this process. And so I'm just gonna say, let's just pick a matching with a very low mean to start off with. Okay, and so what does this look like? Well, the students kind of anticipate this low mean as zero. On the x-axis is the student score. On the y-axis is the share of students of that type enrolling. And what we can see is, look, well, because of the uniform distribution, if all the students with scores above 1 minus q show up, that's going to fill all the seats. Well, all the students have some kind of strictly positive intrinsic utility, v theta, from showing up. And because they anticipate the mean to be down here, they all say, well, okay, I'm not gonna suffer this peer loss, so everyone above 1 minus q is gonna wanna show up. And so the first period matching is gonna look like this. Okay. Now the students are surprised. They said, well, I was expecting the mean to be down here, but actually it's over here. And so the mean is now here. What do the students do? They say, well, okay, in the next period, the students who are above this, they say, okay, well, I'm still above the mean. I'm not gonna suffer any loss, I'm gonna show up. But the students below the mean, now they suffer this loss. And only the ones who have intrinsic preferences that are sufficiently high to overwhelm this, this peer component are gonna show up. So the matching is gonna look something like this, right? We're gonna have this long, long tail. And if we look at the mean of this matching, well, okay, it's just gonna be down here. And now what have we found? Well, we're back in the exact same position we were in the first period. The students are expecting in the third period the mean to be down here. All the students above 1 minus q are gonna say, hey, let me show up, okay? And so it's gonna cycle. So the odd periods are gonna look like this, and the even periods are gonna look like this, okay? The previous results said if and only if everything converges, have we found a stable matching? We haven't found a stable matching. Okay. And so, of course, there's some question about, is this realistic? And here's this guide, this Chinese College Admissions Guide, which says, look, you should really be paying attention to this, right? So if the university has a history of great and small years, you should pay attention to this cyclicality, right? So students are seemingly not aware of this, even though it does seem to be happening. And so what's going on? Well, the mean we can think of as the price. So as the price goes up, the school's becoming, this program C is becoming less attractive to everyone. Okay, that's good. So that looks something like individual gross substitutes, right? Price goes up, I don't like it as much. But the demand for some students is actually de facto going up. And why is that? Well, there's a capacity constraint and there's a unit demand. So what's happening is the medium scoring students are dropping out when the mean gets high and the low scoring students are jumping in. And these guys are dragging down the mean, which is causing the price effectively to go down, and it's creating this cycle as in SCARF. Okay, so it's some kind of violation of aggregate gross substitutes. So I showed that the functional form matters a little bit. We can take this to the data, but let me just end up here. And let me just say, how useful are matching mechanisms based on wrong models? Of course, I just gave you a small sliver of the paper, but at the very least, we're not paying attention, I think, to the past enough in the sense of students are kind of blindly going with what they see in the past, and this can lead to real problems of stability. In the paper, of course, we can show that maybe sometimes this does converge, maybe it doesn't. We construct some conditions under which it does, but even so, there's real room for market design, because even if you think this process is naturally going to converge, in the long run we're going to get a stable matching, well, you're sacrificing some cohorts at the beginning to get there. And even so, like, this is under the best case scenario where the market really is a clone every year. But you might think that programs enter and leave, and that really gets to be, well, okay, if programs are entering and leaving, the information from last year in the best case is gonna be stale. And so we're gonna be always dealing with this little bit of uncertainty, this little bit of instability. And so what we show in the paper is this really leads to higher attrition. It leads to higher attrition among lower scoring students. And these are correlated with low SES backgrounds and being Aboriginal students. And so really, if you care about efficiency, or this is some notion of stability, well, attrition's bad. If you don't even care about that, but you care about equity, well, it's not the case that this is hitting everyone equally. So there's real room for market design. We suggest the mechanism in this paper. We think it improves on things. But I think there's still a lot to do. So thank you very much. Feel free to ask any questions or email them to me. Do we have time for questions?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We have time for one question, either from in-person audience or on Gather. Okay, I see a question.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the talk. I was wondering,
great, and so the question was, what if the students have the opposite kind of cost where they like to have better peers, something like that? That's totally allowable in the model. That functional form was just for the purpose of the example. So the same things can happen. In fact, what we can show is you pick your favorite kind of functional form of student preferences, you tell me that, and almost surely I can construct a market where this won't converge. Almost surely I can construct a market where it does converge, right? And so really we have this characterization of you know, if you were the best econometrician and you could perfectly characterize everyone's peer preferences, would that be enough just by itself to know are the markets going to function well or not? And the answer we really have is almost surely the answer is maybe. So, but in a formal sense. Thanks for the question.
Great. Thank you, Bobby, for the talk.